Hello, my name is Joey Bosmans. I'm working as an engineer at Sirius, the technology center in Belgium. Thanks for viewing this recording of a presentation with the title New Icing, Anti-Icing Coatings and Technologies. This presentation was prepared and presented at a symposium organized by Atypic on February 2021. In the following 20 minutes, I would like to present the topics of anti-icing coatings and to briefly discuss the different technologies which are currently explored to mitigate snow and ice. I would also like to show the possibilities regarding ice testing within our organization of Sirius. But let us first discuss why companies are interested in anti-ice coatings or functional surfaces which can prevent ice from forming. Icing occurs under different conditions, and although more frequently a problem in Arctic conditions, also we in Belgium also consider icing as a burden. Problems can be related to safety, such as slipping hazards or falling ice, product reliability, economical losses due to standstill, or extra fuel cost because of the weight increase, for instance, on ships, or the additional electrical cost using electrical de-icing systems. As icing affects different sectors, there is a huge interest in ways to prevent ice from forming, or to find good ways to monitor icing events and control the de-icing mechanisms. As ice is formed under different conditions of temperature, humidity, and wind speed, different types of ice can be found. The picture shows examples of rime ice, which forms under relatively high temperatures, which is slow cooling and no air. The supercooled liquid droplets freeze upon impact on the surface. Rime ice has a milky translucent color. Examples can be found in nature on white trees. Another type of ice is glaze ice, which is formed while large droplets are formed on a continuous layer of ice. It has a very high density and a clear color. Examples are icicles or clear ice formed on grass and branches. Ice formation and ice adhesion are difficult to predict, and ice layers are difficult to remove. The ideal scenario is to prevent ice from forming. An example is the use of anti-icing chemicals, such as shown on the left picture of the slide. However, ice is easily formed and industry is seeking for easy and cheap ways to remove ice. For instance, on boats, ski lifts, or ice formed on buildings, mechanical removal of ice is still very common. As de-icing is often time-consuming, unsafe, and hard work under difficult conditions, industry is seeking for more controlled and reliable ways to remove ice. One way to do this is via active de-icing systems, such as electrical powered heatable coatings, inflatable boots, or vibrational removal of ice. This, however, requires the use of energy and can therefore be a costly operation. Therefore, they are often only applied to the most crucial parts or components, and for some application, it is just not feasible to install such systems. Therefore, passive de-icing system in the form of coatings or functional surfaces are of interest. However, to enable ice to shed due to natural wind, coated surfaces need to have very low ice adhesion strength. There has been a huge focus on the creation of new coating types or of functional surface structures with very low ice adhesion strengths, as low as 1 kilopascal, have been reported. However, most of these surfaces lack the level of durability which is required to perform under the condition of high demanding applications. as reapplication of coating is often very difficult, a minimum level of durability is expected. Of course, there is the option to combine a coating with an active de-icing system, where a coating can lower the adhesive bond between the ice and the surface, so that a lower amount of power or energy is required to remove the ice. Although most of the coatings are focused on reducing the adhesion force, there are, however, some which can stretch the time upon freezing by lowering the amount of nucleation points, such as, for instance, the superhydrophobic coatings, or by decreasing the nucleation temperature by the use of additives. In order to validate the potential of anti-ice coatings, it is important to understand the working mechanisms and to adapt testing protocols to prove their working principle. As many producers of coatings state that they can optimize their systems depending on the application, it is therefore important to be able to perform testing under controlled conditions. This also allows end users to get an idea of the expected performance, durability, and estimated lifetime of their protective system. Cirrus has been in contact with many suppliers of anti-ice coatings all over the world, from US, Japan, and the northern part of Europe. We were able to identify different classes of anti-icing coatings, and in the following slides, I would like to discuss these classes in more detail. Class 1 stands for elastomeric and hydrophobic coatings, which are often composed of polymers with hydrophobic groups, such as silicon or fluor groups, which have the ability to shed water. They are mostly two-component coatings, which are highly durable and are formulated to offer some ice protection. In some cases, the ice repellency can be tuned by changing the composition depending on the application. However, it is often necessary to find the balance with durability. Such coatings can be found on the hull of ships or on the wind blades. A second class of coatings are superhydrophobic coatings, which are characterized by very high water contact angles and low roll-off angles. Such coatings are based on the lotus leaf effect, where the water droplets just bounce off the surface due to a dual surface roughness, in combination with low surface energy polymers. Several companies sell these coatings as anti-icing coatings, although they often lack durability, and application is limited to less demanding applications. Coatings are used to prevent snow and ice from forming on satellite dishes, conductor cables, or condensed units. In order to create more durable surfaces, there is ongoing research focused on the replication of structured surface with a larger durability level. Class 3 coatings are elastomeric coatings based on PDMS, which is polydimethylsiloxane, a silicon structure. Also liquid-infused coatings, they are based on a porous structure of PDMS in combination with lubricating fluids. These fluids will migrate to the surface and form a liquid-like surface on the interface between coating and ice. Such slips coatings are discussed in many applications, and scientists are able to reach very low adhesive strength. The main concern is, however, the depletion of the liquid at the surface, limiting the functional lifetime of the coating. Research is ongoing to develop more durable slips coatings, which can be, for instance, thermally sprayed. A fourth class of coatings are sol-gel coatings, or so-called nano-coatings. Such coatings are glass-like coatings. They are often grafted with hydrophobic groups, and the so-called hybrid sol-gel coatings, they combine the rigid inorganic structure with more flexible polymer network. Such transparent coatings can be used on, for instance, windshields, covers of optical sensors, or, as shown on the picture, on the canopy of an aircraft as a transparent protective anti-icing layer. Crack initiating coatings, they will not shed the ice, but as ice is built up on these coatings, the coatings are created by flexible polymer segments combined with harder segments in the structure. Therefore, they can form multiple fracture sites in the coating, which allow ice to be removed with less effort. Similar to some of the hydrophobic coatings, the balance between ice adhesion and the durability can be tuned depending on the required application. A new type of anti-icing coatings, which is under investigation, consists of the incorporation of phase-changing materials into a polymer matrix. When homogeneous dispersed, these phase-change materials can release high amounts of latent heat and can produce local shear stresses on surfaces due to their volume change during icing conditions. Such coatings are found to delay the formation of ice. Phase break coatings sell a transparent two-component paint which can be applied in thin layers and was developed and tested by US Defense. It is not clear how the durability of this coating is in relation to certain icing conditions. Therefore, it's still under investigation. The next class of coatings are heatable coatings. This type of coatings will not produce heat by themselves, but need to be connected to an energy source. They come as a conductive paint or a coating based on graphene, carbon, or carbon nanotubes. They should be used in combination with conductive tracks to allow a homogeneous heat distribution over the surface. After being connected, they can be overcoated by a top coat. There is research to produce the coatings as transparent coatings, and some systems are created using foamed graphene to reduce the weight, which is important in aviation. Some companies also sell already prepared foils or tapes, which can be retrofitted to aircraft wings. There is a huge interest in anti-ice coatings, and a lot of research is ongoing, focusing on improving durability of existing systems or to incorporate new technologies. There is also great interest in creating functional surfaces by the use of laser patterning to create specific roughness patterns. These could act as more durable superhydrophobic coatings or can form the base of a structure in combination with a coating. A major challenge has been the creation of large-scale surfaces and functionalization of complex shapes. However, there is strong belief that robotic-directed modules would fill the gap. This overview summarizes all discussed coatings, and it shows that there is no single best solution. One needs a balance between durability and the required ice shedding function. It also emphasizes that it is important to be able to test the different solutions in real-time conditions, such as wind tunnel tests or large-scale icing tests. Anti-ice coatings are being developed since 1950s, and yet there have been no proven commercial viable and durable coating on the market, which can overcome the problems of ice. On the other hand, coatings have been improved and are being used in many applications. If we look towards future research, there should be a clear focus on improving durability and the offering of low energy self-powered systems. There is a lack of internal standards and environmental testing. As icing is formed under different and varying climatic conditions, it is therefore important to be able to reproduce such conditions. Ceres offers a large scale a climate chamber as an alternative to field testing or wind tunnel testing. We equipped an array with 25 spray nozzles, which allow the reproduction of different icing types over an area of approximately 26 square meters. This allows us to test large-scale products or to test large-scale testing of coated parts in one single run. Testing will include product design, reliability testing, feasibility testing, and development products, either as one-on-one projects with companies or as part of new research projects. A future focus of Ceres is the guidance of companies towards the improved de-icing methods involving the use of coatings of functional surfaces, and this altogether with a clear focus on large-scale testing, representing real-life conditions. Ceres will try to show the potential of new developments with a high focus on the durability and reliability of new developments. The following slides shows some of the interesting links to two major projects that we are currently conducting. The Fighting Ice Cook project is a national initiative in Belgium, while the Horizon New Skin project is a European project. The projects have been realized thanks to funding either by Horizon 2020 or by Vlio subsidy in Belgium. If you would have further questions regarding icing or ice testing, please get in touch with Ceres or myself. I would like to thank you for your attention.